Ramona, welcome to New Mexico in Focus.
Thank you, Antonia. It's good to be here. Thanks for having me.
Well, you're already well known for your filmmaking. Now here we have an acclaimed debut novel, Shudder. Different form of storytelling for you. How did this book come about?
Well, I couldn't, 5 years ago I would have told you I don't know, even know if I could make it happen. I've never thought of myself as a fiction writer. Even the beginning of that particular book started out as a documentary idea. I thought maybe I would like to do a documentary about Navajos who deal with death in their jobs, people like police officers, doctors, pathologists, scientists, and, you know, talk about what is ingrained, how is death so foreboding for Navajo people, and why do we have our beliefs? And so I started doing research on that, but in the process of doing that, I realized that I don't know if it would make a great documentary. Not a lot of people wanted to talk to me about that, you know? So it kind of put a squash on that. But at the same time, I started to think about my own life working as a forensic videographer here in Albuquerque and how that would make an interesting story. So I kind of did an introspective and started to think, well, maybe other people don't want to talk about it, but I can talk about it. I dealt with it for 16 years. And then it started, and I was in a workshop up in Los Luceros at the time. So that, me quitting my job as a forensic videographer and then also taking these classes at the same time, I think kind of melded. And the early short stories that I would write about my grandmother and these kind of short ghost stories I started to write as part of my workshop kind of melded together, and it started to turn into this. But once I went to APD's Civilian Forensic Academy here in Albuquerque, I think it really cemented it for me. And I was already at school at IAIA getting my MFA. The mentor I had up at Los Luceros basically told me that she didn't think I should go into screenwriting. She thought I should go into fiction because of the way I write. If it wasn't for her saying that to me, I probably wouldn't even have thought about writing this story into a book. It would have probably been another screenplay that never got produced. So I'm glad she sent me in that direction, because after 2 years in my MFA program, I was able to turn all those short stories into that, and at least the early draft. So it was a very long 10 years of writing in between film projects and in between parenting and all the craziness of life. So it took me 10 years to finish it, but I'm really happy with where it ended up, and I'm glad that I decided to go this direction. It's so much less stressful than filmmaking, and it's, you know, you don't have to worry about the budget when you're writing fiction like you do when you're writing screenplays. I think that was a big hindrance for me. I'd always be thinking, oh, you can't afford this, you know, when I'm trying to write a story in a screenplay format. So when I wrote this, it was like I didn't have to worry about that. You're free to tell whatever story you want and include whatever facts or whatever stories you want to make up into it, and it comes to fruition. So it took me a while, and I think that writing is still one of my least favorite activities. I'll admit, I don't like writing. I might be good at it, but I don't like to do it. So I'm just, you know, I'm just glad it actually came to fruition, and I'm starting to like writing a little bit more than filmmaking now.
And so how much of what's in here is based on your own life, your own experiences? You are a photographer, you mentioned taking some of these classes and your work prior to your filmmaking. So how much of your life, I mean, you're from the Navajo Nation. I really connected with the grandmother in the story. I mean, I was really close with my Navajo grandmother. Mm-hmm. So how much of it are people going to find that you put in with your own life experiences?
Well, I think almost all of the stuff with the grandma and the character comes from things that my grandma and myself did. I mean, I grew up with my grandma a good portion of my childhood, and, you know, those are real things that we experienced and things that she would talk to me about, and, you know, I think pretty much all of that is part of me. I may have embellished here and there, but those are my memories. And growing up in Tohatchi, I really wanted to make Tohatchi a character of the book. because that's my hometown, and you know, and it's really important for me to showcase it and you know, talk about it the way I always remember it. The current stuff with the forensics, a lot of it is based on real cases that I learned about as part of my forensic training with APD. You know, I changed facts, but the basic root of some of these crimes and some of these incidents that take place in Albuquerque are real. And some of it's taken from my own experiences working with as a forensic videographer. And just thinking about how my work impacted like my emotions and how I would think about people who I filmed for legal reasons for years, for months. I mean, their stories and their lives would impact me deeply. And I kind of used those emotions and gave them to Rita in a different way. Of course, I didn't see ghosts, and I didn't communicate with ghosts while I was working forensics. That would have probably made it a little easier. But I was able to use my emotions that I had working those cases and give them to Rita as kind of a supernatural power instead, because they evoke the same emotions in her. And she would think about their families and who they left behind. And that's what motivates you to do that kind of work, even if it's something that is so taboo in your own culture and something that you grew up having a deep fear of. When you work in that kind of industry, you realize pretty quick that you're there to bring justice. You're there to speak for the people who can't speak for themselves. And it turns into a different vocation then. It turns into a different thing. You're not just taking photographs, and you're affecting people's lives. And so it's very important. Yeah, so in that same way that Rita does.
And to add to that, it is, you know, a crime and supernatural aspects of this book. And we know there are a lot of taboos out there in tribes across the country, just not Navajo Nation, but a lot of tribes. So how did you approach that? Are you worried, or were you worried about any backlash or any criticism?
I am worried. you know, the book comes out tomorrow, and I have to say, when I was in the process of writing it, I would often say, oh, geez, are you going to write that? Are you going to put that in? What would your grandma say? You know, I mean, I had those internal dialogues with myself. How are Navajos going to take this story? And I realized that, I did a lot of research about death and about how Navajos came to this pinnacle of being so afraid of death that you don't even talk about it. It's not something that's even supposed to be a part of your life. And I began to realize that looking at other cultures and looking at other rituals around the world, and doing deep research about all these different, how different people believe and how different people think about it, I kind of felt that the Diné are real anchored to the Spanish flu. And I think the Spanish flu epidemic really had a huge impact on how Navajos feel about death and their fear of it, because before that, the research really doesn't show that. It's like they're moving on to the next world. It's a rebirth. And then at some point, it turns into this evil monster. And for me, I felt like this is a good time to have these discussions. Instead of hiding from them, we need to face them. And I think that a lot of people, like the Navajo Nation Human Rights Commission, are even starting to talk about traditional funeral practices and about how we deal with death. And so I think even in mainstream academia, we're starting to really think about that and wonder if there's a different way to approach things. And so I thought that it would be a good opening for dialogue. But at the same time, I also thought, well, you know, for decades, Diné have been reading Tony Hillerman, and he talks all kinds of spooky stuff that I would never put in a book, never. And they read those books. So reading something like this that I know I didn't put any sensitive knowledge in because I know better, that they should be fine reading this book. And if we want to have a discussion about death and we want to talk about those taboos, now's the time to do it. And it's time to face it instead of running away from it. So I think it opens us up for some healthy discussions, both about that and about who we let tell our stories. So I look forward to having this dialogue with whoever is ready to have it. you know.
And that's definitely my next question is, move over, Tony Hillerman. But really, as an Indigenous person, sharing Indigenous stories through whatever, if it's through a book, through its filmmaking, mm-hmm. we know there are not a lot of non-Native writers out there who mm-hmm. are writing about the Navajo Nation, who are yeah. writing about other tribes across the country. So what does it mean for you as an Indigenous person, as a woman, to be sharing and telling a story through this book, something that we understand and we know, you know, what the do's and don'ts of?
Well, I think it really illustrates the importance of having somebody from a community represent that community and tell that story. Because not only do you get falsehoods and stories written about people or written about us from people outside of our communities, I think there's a lot of falsehoods. I think there's a lot of chance for romanticizing our way of life. There's a lot of time, a lot of chance to stereotype us. And that continues to happen. And it always boggles the mind to me. I never tell stories outside of my community because, I mean, even if I was going to tell a story about a Pueblo community, I make sure that they have exhausted every resource to find somebody from their own community to do that. And if they don't find somebody, at least we can include some young people as part of the project. So they're in development. There will be somebody who can take over these stories after, you know, I'm gone. But that's really important to me. Even through my film work, it's always been a real thorn to me to find people who continue to make these stories and continue to get funded to tell our stories when our own Indigenous filmmakers are struggling to make ends meet, are struggling to have their projects financed. So for me, it's a big stick. So writing a book like this, I think, really shows that deep understanding of cultural taboo, the deep understanding of what stories you tell, what stories you have the right to tell, what stories that you should be telling. There are some stories that you should not be telling, and a lot of those people who don't come from our communities are telling that stories when they shouldn't. And, you know, I can't stop that from happening. People are going to do what they do. But the trick is to have these discussions so that people understand why it's wrong. People understand why you don't tell that story. Out of respect, out of traditional belief, you don't tell that story, or you only tell that story during a certain part of the year. You know, people don't understand that because they don't come from our communities. So it's really important to educate these people that are trying to, you know, make these films or write these books. And if you're living in a tribal community, like in a Pueblo, or you're living on the Navajo Nation, and people who are not Navajo or who don't come from your Pueblo community are approaching you about filming you, about interviewing you, about taking your own knowledge, your traditional knowledge, and putting it in their book, really think about that. Really think about who this person is and where they come from, what their intentions are, and if you should share. Because a lot of times they'll take advantage, and they'll tell the outside world about things we never intended to let them know about. So it's really important to think about that, both as a writer and as somebody who is part of a community and is approached by somebody from outside. You know, I think a lot of times people are just eager to have their stories told, and so when somebody comes and they have a microphone and a camera, they're finally excited to tell their story, and they'll let anybody tell their story, and then that person will take it and turn it into something they never intended. So watch out. That's all I have to say about that.
Well, yeah. And you talked a little bit about helping the next generation with your filmmaking, and definitely our young people and tribal communities here in New Mexico and across the country, they're already storytellers. Every young person I know has some kind of smart device in there. Right. Sharing stories already. So if, you know, what can pique the interest of some Native youth who maybe want to become a writer, or maybe they mm-hmm. want to become a filmmaker? What's your advice to them?
Well, I think my biggest advice is not to give up. I've been in the film industry for over 25 years, and I'm always like, nobody's really seen my films. I think a lot of people in New Mexico have, because we have a great support for our local film industry. So people know who I am locally in New Mexico. But outside of that, not a lot of people have seen our films or have seen the work that my husband and I do. And we work really hard. And we try to get our content out there, and we work on projects constantly. And it's not always, you're not going to hit Hollywood like right away. I think that's something that I even believed in when I was first starting out. Like, all it takes is one good story and you could, you know, Quentin Tarantino it into Hollywood. That's not how it works. And so the best thing about being a filmmaker, or the most important thing, I think, about being a filmmaker is you have the power to document history, to document language, to document tradition. And I think that's something that a lot of tribes, even like the Navajo people or the Pueblos, don't really have a fondness for being photographed and for being recorded. But intertribally, within your Pueblo, I think it's really important to create media, to create language libraries, to create audio and video libraries, where we start to film our elders. We start to preserve our beliefs, our customs, our languages, and use them internally. That information doesn't have to leave the Navajo Nation Museum. It doesn't have to leave local Pueblo libraries or local Pueblo governments, but it can affect generations for years to come because they'll have documented resources from tribal elders. That is the most important thing about being a filmmaker, is documenting that history and documenting the extraordinary people that come in and out of our lives in these tribal communities. For me, it was documenting my mom making this giant painting, or documenting my neighbor who used to sheep herd for 50 some years and was stopping because she was just too tired of walking her sheep up the mountains every year. You know, that kind of stuff is what is so important about telling our stories. Because if we don't tell them, even if nobody ever sees them, or they don't make some huge, you know, impact, like they don't get into Sundance or they don't get into Tribeca, forget that. Forget that. That's not why you're making these films. You're making these films for your community. If somebody puts their smart cap on and decides to put you into a film festival, good for them. But you didn't make that film for these people. You made that film for your community, you know? And that's what's important when you're a young, up-and-coming filmmaker and you're wanting to make an impact. That's your impact, you know? That's your impact. So I think it's really important for them to know that, you know? It's not important whether you get into Sundance or you do any of that other stuff. That's not important. It's important that you've preserved something and made something for your community. They'll always remember.
And like you said, it took 10 years or more. Well, congratulations. Yes. And
thank you,
anything,
Antonia.
Any kind of preview you can give us for what's next? Are we going to see a whole bookshelf of, you know,
well,
Rita and her adventures?
I have promised at least a trilogy, because I feel like I don't know if I could write that character beyond three books. So I did promise a trilogy, and I'm in the process of writing the second book right now. We got a first draft, is due in December, so keep your fingers crossed. But the second book is going to be called Exposure, and it's going to continue to follow Rita into her life post-APD.
So well, we look forward to that, and thank you so much for your time here on New Mexico PBS.
Thanks so much, Antonia. It was good. It was fun.